I had two girls some years ago who had a big problem breaking out of their social class. They were prosperous. They were vaguely unsettled and unhappy about the same experiences happening to them over and over again. And even though they were 13, they already were bored with their lives, but they were unable to cross the invisible lines that held them into a limited set of experiences. So I detached them from the school routines for several days with their parents' cooperation, and I dropped them into industrial New Jersey one morning at 4 a.m. in the middle of a fog. Two 13-year-old girls, and I had arranged for a long-distance truck driver who was on his way to North Carolina to let them ride in the cab with him, to get down and watch him unload his load or detach his load, pick something else, and turn around and come back. I think it was a one-day turnaround, but and it started at 4 in the morning, so I dropped them off. They were alone with the problem first of what if he didn't come to pick them up? And I said, well, there are millions of people here who travel back and forth across this river, so somewhere right nearby there must be an inexpensive way to get across the river to return home if he doesn't show up. And then, of course, the larger problems were how would they hold a day-long conversation with this man? How would they fight their own feelings of being in a science fiction movie? How would they make it worth something to them?
Putting a child alone in an unguided setting with a problem to solve is not what we do in our schools. In our classrooms, we rarely give our children chances to discover their own strength, their own inner resources. In fact, we do precisely the opposite, as we shall hear from John Taylor Gatto. Welcome to New Signals on KPFK Los Angeles at 90.7 FM. I'm Barbara Dunlap. John Taylor Gatto has been teaching in New York City schools for 26 years. Over these years, he has won the trust of his students, the resistance of many school administrators, and finally, the acknowledgement of various political forces that what he has to say merits hearing. On January 31st, 1990, as John Taylor Gatto accepted their award as New York City Teacher of the Year, New York State legislators listened. At the least, it must have been confronting. Gatto tossed no bouquets of roses to the nation's culture or its school system. Let me share with you some of what Gatto said. He is speaking to all of us. We live in a time of great school crisis. We rank at the bottom of 19 industrial nations in reading, writing, and arithmetic. At the very bottom. Our teenage suicide rate is the highest in the world. And suicidal kids are rich kids for the most part, not the poor. This great school crisis is interlinked with a greater social crisis in the community. Children and old people are penned up and locked away from the business of the world to a degree without precedent. Nobody talks to them anymore. And without children and old people mixing in daily life, a community has no future and no past, only a continuous present. In fact, the name community hardly applies to the way we interact with each other. We live in networks, not communities, and everyone I know is lonely because of that. School is a major actor in this tragedy, as it is a major actor in the widening gulf among social classes. Using school as a sorting mechanism, we appear to be on the way to creating a caste system complete with untouchables who wander through subway trains begging and sleeping upon the streets. I've noticed a fascinating phenomenon in my years of teaching, that schools and schooling are increasingly irrelevant to the great enterprises of the planet. No one believes anymore that scientists are trained in science classes, or politicians in civics classes, or poets in English classes. The truth is that schools don't really teach anything except how to obey orders. It's not the fault of bad teachers or too little money spent. It's just impossible for education and schooling ever to be the same thing. Schools were designed by Horace Mann and by Sears and Harper of the University of Chicago and Thorndike of Columbia Teachers College and some others to be instruments of the scientific management of a mass population. Schools are intended to produce, through the application of formulae, human beings whose behavior can be predicted and controlled. Because community life, which protects the dependent and weak, is dead, and only networks remain, the only successful people in our national order are independent, self-reliant, confident, and individualistic. Well-schooled people are irrelevant. They can sell film and razor blades, push paper and talk on telephones, or sit mindlessly before a flickering computer terminal. But as human beings, they are useless. Useless to others, and useless to themselves. These challenging words are those of New York City school teacher John Taylor Gatto. His outspoken critique of schooling comes to you over listener-sponsored KPFK Los Angeles. Stay tuned at 90.7 FM. Remember the two well-heeled 13-year-old girls Gatto sent off on a long haul with a trucker to broaden their horizons?
What happened to the girls in the with the trucker in New Jersey?
They had just a sensational time. These girls, recognizing suddenly that they weren't limited by their social class or their attitudes, and that there was a big, vast, and fascinating world out there to learn about, began to generate their own tours of that world.
And so these girls played a central role in offering their schoolmates real-life adventures as an antidote to schooling's force-fed abstractions. Gatto says, "It is absurd and anti-life to be part of a system that compels you to sit in confinement with people of exactly the same age and social class. That system effectively cuts you off from the immense diversity of life. It is absurd and anti-life to move from cell to cell at the sound of a gong for every day of your natural youth in an institution that allows you no privacy and even follows you into the sanctuary of your home, demanding that you do its homework. How will they learn to read, you say? And my answer is, when children are given whole lives instead of age-graded ones in cell blocks, they learn to read, write, and do arithmetic with ease, if those things make sense in the kind of life that unfolds around them. But keep in mind, Gatto adds, in the United States, almost nobody who reads, writes, or does arithmetic gets much respect. We are a land of talkers. We pay talkers the most and admire talkers the most. And so our children talk constantly, following the public models of television and school teachers. It is very difficult to teach the basics anymore because they really aren't basic to the society we've made. Two institutions at present control our children's lives, television and schooling, in that order. Both of these reduce the real world of wisdom, fortitude, temperance, and justice to a never-ending, non-stop abstraction. In centuries past, the time of a child and adolescent would be occupied in real work, real charity, real adventures, and the realistic search for mentors who might teach what you really wanted to learn. A great deal of time was spent in community pursuits, practicing affection, learning how to make a home, and dozens of other tasks necessary to become a whole man or woman.
If you want people to specialize, if you want your typist to only type and your janitor to only dump wastebaskets, you really have to breed a new type of person that never existed before, because people naturally want to do everything and do naturally do everything. The I guess the best model for that, and probably the best model for an economy, is the small farm. I mean, the joy is in plowing and seeding and tending and carving and glazing yourself.
Yes.
And it really doesn't matter whether it's as good as you could buy, as long as it's good enough for what the situation calls for. It'll get better as you keep doing it.
Yes.
But to make specialists, I think, is to dehumanize people.
My partner Richard here has been a wonderful person in my life because he's taught himself how to do all kinds of things, and he's very self-reliant. And I, on the other hand, always flattered myself that I knew how to find the best expert whose assistance I could purchase.
That's what Harvard teaches you. You must have gone to Stanford, the Harvard of the West.
No, but something like that. And I'll tell you, at this ripe age in my life, it's been a real comeuppance to discover that I'm not so smart after all. That, in fact, I would have been a lot better off and much more secure in myself if I had learned to do things for myself and not be able to network for the best professional.
Yes.
One of my most popular programs on the air was a conversation I had with Kathleen Kenny, who's a woman out here who built her own house with her own hands.
Oh, I'd love to know her. I'd love to know her house.
Yes. It's gorgeous. It's a small house, and it's spectacularly well-built and beautifully finished, and she designed it herself. It's octagonal, no less. It doesn't even have right angles in it. And she got through all the bureaucracy. She passed all the building and inspections and electrical and everything first time out.
If we just were able to broadcast that message to each other, not in a vapid or foolish way, but if we just said, nothing's very hard to do. I'll help you a little bit. You know, and someone else help you a little bit, but you can help yourself almost all the way. Building your own house. God knows, Barbara, that's what we ought to be doing. Next to raising your own kids, what could possibly be more fulfilling, would teach you more, and then would pay you off for a more continuous length of time?
Time, private time, that is what our children need to discover who they are, to build themselves. Gatto has calculated the number of hours of private time left to the children he teaches after television and schooling devour their share. Out of the 169 hours in each week, children spend 55 hours watching television, only 1 hour less than they sleep. With the coming and going to school, with school classes and its homework, school consumes 45 hours, all under constant surveillance. If you allot 3 hours a week for evening meals, Gatto arrives at a net amount of private time for each child of 9 hours. In these 9 hours, we expect a child, in Gatto's words, to fashion a self, to create a unique consciousness. Gatto says, it's not enough, is it? The richer the kid, of course, the less television he watches. But the rich kid's time is just as narrowly proscribed by a somewhat broader catalog of commercial entertainments. And his inevitable assignment to a series of private lessons in areas seldom of his own choice. But these things are just a more cosmetic way to create dependent human beings, unable to fill their own hours, unable to initiate lines of meaning to give substance and pleasure to their existence. It's a national disease, this dependency and aimlessness, and I think schooling and television and lessons have a lot to do with it. Think of the things which are killing us as a nation. Narcotic drugs, brainless competition, recreational sex, the pornography of violence, gambling and alcohol, and the worst pornography of all, lives devoted to buying things, accumulation as a philosophy. All of them are addictions of dependent personalities, and this is what our brand of schooling must inevitably produce. You are listening to the words which John Taylor Gatto offered New York State senators in accepting their acclaim as New York City Teacher of the Year for 1990. And how does he describe our children who emerge from their classes blinking in the sunshine? Rich or poor, school children who face the 21st century cannot concentrate on anything for very long. They have a poor sense of time past and time to come. They are mistrustful of intimacy, like the children of divorce they really are, for we have divorced them from significant parental attention. They hate solitude. They are cruel, materialistic, dependent, passive, violent, timid in the face of the unexpected, and addicted to distraction.
I think one of the things, Barbara, that we've all noticed about schooled kids, whether they're privately schooled or publicly schooled, is the vapid quality, the emptiness, the frivolity at a time when not only the world but our own nation seems to be coming unglued. The air and the water and the earth are only forgiving up to a point. They're not infinitely flexible, and we have apparently transgressed some time ago that outer limit of forgiveness. I think in the New York Times a month or so ago, in dealing with the pollution problem they have, that the figure occurred that 1 out of 6 acres in the entire Soviet Union is unlivable because of the intensity of industrial poisons of one kind or another, or radioactivity that's on the land. I mean, that's a very short slice of the historical pie to eliminate 1/6 of your territory for the indefinite future. In order to eat a lettuce from California in Manhattan, Schumacher's figure, I believe, was 85,000 calories have to be expended in raising that lettuce in California and transporting the lettuce 3,000 miles, storing it and retransporting it 3 or 4 times in the city before it reaches me. And the lettuce will yield up 80 or 100 calories. So we've been deficit spending to the point where it can't go on any longer.
Yes.
And it can't go on not because moralists will stop it. It will stop it going on itself.
Yes.
It's self-correcting.
Yes. Then what?
Well, I'm glad you say then what, because when we talk about schools, we're really talking about a small part of a very large problem. We've constructed an economy that's insane. I'm sitting here as I speak to you with a list that comes from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, so I assume that it's as close to something believable as we're ever going to get, a list of the 25 most common jobs that are going to occur over the next 10 years. The number of janitors that will be required over the next 10 years is 30% more than all the information and computer jobs that will be required put together. The janitor will be the commonest job in the United States by the year 2000. Then comes sales clerk, then secretary, then office clerk, then cashier, waiter, waitress, truck driver, metalwork operator, cooks and chefs, blue-collar supervisors, store managers, kitchen helpers. There's a long list of jobs, very few of which really lead to a life that anyone at the age of 10 would want. And I don't think many people at the age of 30 or 40 want them.
Mm-hmm.
22.5% of all the jobs in this country are a peculiar category called guard jobs. Better than one job out of five is guarding something: police, judicial employees, security personnel, the armed forces, civilian jobs that depend on the Pentagon, makers of security equipment. What does that tell us about the economy we fashioned, that one out of five people has to watch other people for fear of trouble?
You are listening to New York City school teacher John Taylor Gatto. What's the only way out for our children? Stay tuned to KPFK Los Angeles.
If you were to ask me where we're going to go from here, I'd have to say something very bleak as a society. I can't see where the wedge will enter to upset this structure and a new structure other than simply allowing it to collapse of its own weight, which is basically what happened to classical Greece and to Rome and to Egypt, to all the civilizations that we have record of. Some people were aware of what was wrong. Maybe many were aware, but no one seemed able to get their hands on the controls and divert it. So when you're in a situation like that, what do? You turn to an exploration of your inner space. You make yourself, or you constantly make and remake yourself, the best you can be. Not you in competition, but you against yourself or against the potential that's built into your biology or into your culture or into your neighborhood, into your circumstances.
How do you introduce children to that inner encounter with themselves?
But I think there's things you can see about a person and about a person's strengths and lacks just by submerging your own self and watching them closely for a short time. They almost tell you without words what they wish they weren't or what they wish they were. So what I do now is to watch kids and attempt to nudge them in directions I think that'll confront them with the limitations of the self they are. But I don't nag, and if it doesn't work, I push them back out again. I think experience with a certain amount of risk is immensely cleansing, especially when you're young. Quickly, you put aside all the nonsense you've learned, and it's you against the biggest book of all, what you can do with this situation. I'm not going to say that in 100% of the cases I see the beginning of transformation, but I certainly see it if I'm allowed a free rein this way for, let's say, a year. I see it clearly in a third of the cases, and I see it in embryo in another third. Let me talk about Mark Bilgrey, who now is somebody that you're all welcome to verify. Mark's a real living human being, and he's the best cartoonist for Cosmopolitan and some other things. But Helen Gurley Brown sent him a letter saying, "You're the best cartoonist I have," and he has it framed on his wall. Mark I knew in eighth grade when he was 13, just 20 years ago, or perhaps 24 years ago. Mark was mute. Mark could speak to nobody. He was overwhelmed with, I guess, the shame of being Mark, or the inability to talk to people he wanted to talk to or to represent his ideas clearly. On the other hand, I saw that he was very, very industrious. He'd squirrel himself away under my protection in some corner of the room, and he never didn't have something to do. He didn't hang out vacantly. So in the course of him coming to trust me that I wasn't going to judge him adversely and I wouldn't use my protection of his, it was art that he was doing, as a kind of a club to make him do other things I wanted. As he came to trust me, he said, "What do you think I ought to do?" I said, "Mark, I think you're in the most desperate situation that a human being can be in, because your inability to talk to anybody else is going to cost you comrades and companions, and it'll cost you someone to love almost certainly. And the price it's going to exact from you is so great, and yet how to climb that mountain, I said, is so far out of the range of my understanding at your age. I mean, I know it's tough," I said, "and I know that you're not going to be able to do it gradually." And he said, "Well, what would you do?" I said, "Look," I said, "at this time. The Improvisation had recently opened in New York City, and the owners of the Improvisation, the Goodmans, I believe the name were, lived in my building, so I knew about these clubs. And they had spawned a few imitators, one of which was Catch a Rising Star in New York. And I knew they had a lineup out front where amateurs could get a ticket, and they didn't screen these people. They'd get to go on amateur night and try to entertain a nightclub audience. So I said, Mark, I said, why don't we put together a comedy routine, and you'll go on the stage at Catch a Rising Star. You'll sit in line all day long, you know, and you get a ticket, and you go on stage. I said, and the people will be furious that you're so bad. I said, they will be. I said, but I'll get a table at ringside with my wife and a few friends, and we'll laugh outrageously, and we'll clap our hands while all the other people are booing and throwing sandwiches at you. And what you'll see is the worst that can happen isn't very bad. So Mark goes over to Catch a Rising Star. He's absolutely paralyzed, though. And he says, I don't think I can do it. And I said, but you've got a tape recorder. So why don't you put your comedy act on a tape recorder? And then when you get up on stage, you just press the button and you stand there and let the tape recorder do your act. He said, but people will be, you know, I'll be mocked and humiliated. I said, right. I said, do it anyway. Well, 2 years later, when he was a paid act at the Improvisation, isn't that fantastic? We're talking about a mute kid. They paid him. They said he couldn't eat house cake. But other than that, almost all the things that plague us, as we learn to either rely on ourselves and be confident, or we learn to basically have contempt for ourselves and to depend on other people, I think we learn by being something other than what comes easily to us. So all these tests have to involve struggle. I used to tell kids until it was coming out of their ears, whatever comes naturally to you, I said, just don't do it all, because you don't need any more practice with that. If I had a kid who could handle himself very well in argument by the time he was in eighth grade in class, I'd take him aside and I'd say, don't raise your hand in class anymore, because you've mastered that lesson. I said, you're as good, and you'll now naturally self-teach yourself to be better and better, and you'll end up being one of the elite 1% or whatever in rhetoric. So you don't need a teacher anymore, and you don't need these cheap victories. Other people need the airtime to expose themselves in front of an audience where they're not going to be hurt. But you need other things.
You are tuned to listener-sponsored Pacifica Radio, KPFK, Los Angeles, at 90.7 FM. I'm Barbara Dunlap. Recently, New York City teacher John Taylor Gatto shared with residents of Toledo, Ohio, his assessment of what he calls government monopoly schooling. In his view, the ongoing national debate about subject matter, teacher training, and school funding misses the real issue. What are we teaching our children now? Seven deadly lessons, says Gatto. Do they sound familiar to you? The first lesson I teach is confusion. I teach the unrelating of everything. I teach the orbiting of planets, the law of large numbers, slavery, adjectives, dance, gymnasium, assemblies, surprise guests, fire drills, computer languages, parents' nights, staff development days, guidance with strangers you may never see again, standardized tests. What do any of these things have to do with each other? Think of all the great natural sequences like learning to walk and learning to talk, following the progression of light from sunrise to sunset, witnessing the ancient procedures of a farm, a smithy, or a shoemaker, watching your mother prepare a Thanksgiving feast. All of the parts are in perfect harmony with each other. Each action justifies itself and illuminates the past and the future. School sequences aren't like that, not inside a single class and not among the total menu of daily classes. School sequences are crazy. I teach the unrelating of everything. What I do is more related to television programming than to making a scheme of order. In a world where home is only a ghost, because both parents work, or because too many moves, or too many job changes, or too much ambition, or something else has left everybody too confused to stay in a family relation, I teach you how to accept confusion as your destiny. The second lesson I teach is your class position. If I do my job well, the kids can't even imagine themselves somewhere else because I've shown them how to envy and fear the better classes and how to have contempt for the dumb classes. That's the real lesson of any rigged competition, like school. You come to know your place. The third lesson I teach is indifference. When I'm at my best, I plan lessons very carefully to produce a show of enthusiasm. But when the bell rings, I insist we drop whatever it is we have been doing and proceed quickly to the next workstation. The lesson of bells is that no work is worth finishing. So why care too deeply about anything? The fourth lesson I teach is emotional dependency. By stars and red checks, smiles and frowns, prizes, honors, and disgraces, I teach you to surrender your will to the predestinated chain of command. Sometimes free will appears right in front of me in pockets of children angry, depressed, or happy about things outside my ken. Rights in such matters cannot be recognized by school teachers, only privileges, which can be withdrawn, hostages to good behavior. The fifth lesson I teach is intellectual dependency. Good people wait for an expert to tell them what to do. It is hardly an exaggeration to say our entire economy depends on this lesson being learned. Think of what might fall apart if children weren't trained to be dependent. The social services businesses could hardly survive. Counselors and therapists would look on in horror as the supply of psychic invalids vanished. Commercial entertainment of all sorts, including television, would wither as people learned again how to make their own fun. Restaurants, prepared food warehouses, and a whole host of other assorted food services would be drastically downsized if people returned to making their own meals rather than depending on strangers to plant, pick, chop, and cook for them. Much of modern law, medicine, and engineering would go too, the clothing business and school teaching as well, unless a guaranteed supply of helpless people poured out of our schools each year. Don't be too quick to vote for school reform if you want to continue getting a paycheck. We've built a way of life that depends on people doing what they are told because they don't know how to tell themselves what to do. It's one of the biggest lessons I teach. For God's sake, don't rock that boat. These are the lessons which veteran New York City teacher John Taylor Gatto says comprise the real curriculum we offer our children, whether rich or poor. The sixth lesson I teach is provisional self-esteem. The lesson of report cards, grades, and tests is that children should not trust themselves or their parents, but should rely on the evaluation of certified officials. Self-evaluation, the staple of every major philosophical system that ever appeared on the planet, is never a factor in these things. People must be told what they are worth. The seventh lesson I teach is that you can't hide. The meaning of constant surveillance and denial of privacy is that no one can be trusted, that privacy is not legitimate. Children must be closely watched if you want a society under tight central control. Children will follow a private drummer if you can't get them into a uniformed marching band. School as it was built is an essential support system for a vision of social engineering that condemns most people to be subordinate stones in a pyramid that narrows as it ascends to a terminal of control. Schools teach exactly what they are intended to teach, and they do it well, how to be a good Egyptian and where your place is in the pyramid. John Taylor Gatto has befriended hundreds of young people in his 26 years of teaching in New York City schools. His trust in them and his wisdom inspired them beyond the reach of classroom bells.
I had another girl who had a problem of negotiation with her own mother. The girl thought she was ready to take long exploratory journeys, and her mother used what the girl thought was the manipulative technique of saying, if you can earn the money to do it, you can go. And what was at stake at this one juncture was the girl going to Paris alone. She was 13 or 14 also. Of course, the amount of money was vast that was required to do that. And I said, don't look at it as a contest between you and your mother. I said, look at it as a tremendous contest between you and your ability to become useful enough, even at your age, to somebody else in New York City, that they'll give you that money in exchange for your service. And what the girl eventually ended up doing, I was just bowled over by this, because I never would have dreamed of it in 40 lifetimes. There are a great many old people's homes on the west side of Manhattan between Columbia and Lincoln Center. And she went around and began to act as an agent for elderly women who could knit sweaters and make socks and all one-of-a-kind things and all very skilled craftsmanship. She assembled this stuff, and then she sold it between Columbia University and Barnard College, which is only a few blocks from the school. The permit was very easy to obtain and very low cost. And in any case, I told her that because of her age, she'd have an unfair advantage since nobody would even question her, and that did happen. She set up many engaging relationships that I think she still maintains.
School teacher John Taylor Gatto goes on to tell his audience in Toledo, I met a wonderful old woman, age 87, in Toledo yesterday, Mrs. Virginia Stranahan, who teaches people about nature and flowers and pottery and making honey by a method that was just like my grandfather's. Virginia says, I teach people by getting out of their way. Gatto discovered, he says, that teaching is not an art like painting at all, whereby the addition of material to a surface, an image is synthetically produced, but much more an art like sculpture, whereby the subtraction of material, an image already locked in the stone, is enabled to emerge. In Mrs. Stranahan's words, you get the useless material out of the way of the image you're trying to produce, which is, of course, the very best human being the student is trying to become. I began to experiment with ways to remove obstacles preventing the inherent genius of children from gathering. I began to devise guerrilla exercises to allow the kids access to the raw materials people have always used to educate themselves: free choice, private time, a relief from constant surveillance and judgment, a broad range of human associations, and a pat on the back when it was needed.
I look at a little newspaper I used to put out so that the kids would see what they had done, and I'm looking here at a 13-year-old boy holding a slice of pizza above his mouth, and I believe the boy's in Duke University Law School now. This paper is 10 years old, but he had made the mistake as a young black kid of going to a pizza parlor that services the collegiate school, one of the aristocratic private schools in the United States, the one that John Kennedy's kid went to. And, of course, the owner of the pizza parlor was terrified that might cost him the business that came from collegiate. So the guy appropriated this kid's pizza and his soda and threw them out on the charge that the boy had taken five straws. And I remember, as though it was yesterday, the outrage, which he came to me and asked me what I was going to do about it. Our school's about three blocks from the pizza parlor and about four blocks from collegiate. And I said, I'm not going to do anything. I said, but there's a lot you can do. And the first thing you can do is just man to man or human being to human being. You can go over there and tell the fellow when it's quiet time that he was way out of line, but that you'll overlook it because you realize he's under pressure if he gives you back your pizza and your soda. And he did that, and he got thrown out again. And he said, now what are you going to do about it? I'm not going to do anything. Because if you can give the guy a second chance to be human about his error, I said, call him on the phone and say you'd like to speak to him, and I'll be your witness. And he did that, and he got hung up on. And he said, now what are you going to do? And I said, write this fellow a letter and send it certified return receipt. That'll only cost you 65 cents in those days. I don't know what it is now. I said, give him a chance again to recognize that you can't treat other people that way. And so we did that, and then he said, what are you going to do? I said, I'm not going to do anything, but for $4, you can sue him in small claims court. I said, you're going to win hands down because you have three sets of evidence that you acted like a reasonable person. And I said, and I can testify to two of them, and this return receipt will testify to the third in the letter. And he did, in fact, get awarded triple damages. And I'm looking at a headline here that says, Pizza Palace sued. 13-year-old wins case in first court appearance. He was awarded triple damages. I think that came to $13.05. And 1 week later, Brooklyn College Law School called and asked if he could come and lecture to the law school. And that was rapidly followed by, I think, every law school in the Northeast. This boy wasn't illiterate, but he was close enough to it. In a very, very short time, in a year or two, he was unrecognizable because he had been recognized as a person of value by people on the outside. Anyway, there are different things for different people, Barbara. But I think in all cases, it requires some kind of solitude, some time alone, somebody not wiping your nose or picking up, but saying, here, I have faith that you can do it. Here's the time.
Yes. You are listening to John Taylor Gatto, school teacher and friend to hundreds of New York City children. Stay tuned to New Signals on KPFK Los Angeles at 90.7 FM. A parent himself, Gatto reminds us that caring for our children once came naturally.
I think the millions of people who are destroying children's lives, and I hesitated, but I used the word advisedly, don't really want to do that. Mm-hmm. I think given some acceptable alternative, they wouldn't do that. But in fact, they don't see an acceptable alternative other than spending more time or investing more of themselves imaginatively and physically. And it's a price that we're taught that only fools pay.
Yes. You know, I just spoke with Joseph Cornell, who is, we'll call him a nature educator, and he said that his parents made raising him and his brothers their first priority in life.
But it can be your first priority not as a duty, but because where else can you get a responsibility as really glorious and interesting as that? I don't think there are other raw materials quite as fascinating. Now, I believe that most of the human race dimly understood this for most of human history. It took a long, concerted effort by industrial interest to convince people that doing that was agonizing, and the best people only did it out of a sense of duty or occasionally out of some mild amusement.
But today, many parents are doing what untold generations of people did naturally before the recent invention of compulsory schools. They are raising and educating their children themselves. Far from being threatened by their commitment and enterprise, teacher John Taylor Gatto applauds them.
It's awe-inspiring. First of all, the performance of the kids on instrumental measures is so staggeringly better than it is from the schools. And I'm not talking about the kids in the schools who, you know, have trouble, but the best classes.
Yes.
I mean, most of these kids I see by the time they're teenagers who've been self-educated at home, mm-hmm, and with their parents' assistance, are so much more mature and insightful and relaxed than I am that I always feel that I should be raising my hand and asking them questions. 2 weeks ago, I was in Toledo, Ohio, to make some speeches, and I stayed at the home of a homeschooling couple who wouldn't at all mind if I used their name. Their son, who's about 17 now, had been homeschooling himself for the past 4 years, I mean, with his parents' cooperation. Andy Ensley is the kid's name, and a lot of your listeners will have seen Andy because in his 4 years of homeschooling, which I guess we'll have to call it, in his 4 years of homeschooling, Andy has managed to talk himself into the cast of the movie Glory, which an awful lot of people have seen, about the Civil War, talk himself into the cast of Dances with Wolves, which a lot of people who are listening must have seen. And when I got to Toledo, he had just returned from 5 weeks in Montana with his mother and father and his sister. But they really, I think, went out as chaperones. Andy had been asked to speculate with his time, making a 10-minute movie sample that someone was going to use to raise money for a Western movie. If the money were raised, then Andy would have a major part in the film. Now, you'd have to see this kid, how sober and serious he is, how much a scholar of the Civil War, which is one of his interests, he is, how practical he is, because he runs a silk screening business that does 10 or 20,000 silk screen bags at a time. You'd assume that he was absolutely a grown man by his maturity, his curiosity. Even his appearance is that of a serious person at a serious time in human history.
Perhaps among these self-reliant and resourceful young people who are not schooling but educating themselves, we will find the inspiration to let go our reliance on professional experts, political dogma, and corporate agenda for what Gatto calls the lines of meaning in our lives.
Isn't it true that the only people that can teach anything are people in the white heat of learning themselves? Now, I'm talking about education. You can train somebody in some simple operation and know that operation inside out yourself. But if you want someone to become educated, what you have to do, it seems to me, is to awaken their mind to the passion of discovery. And you don't do that by memorizing things and giving them back on a test.
Heeding his own advice to master new challenges, John Taylor Gatto threw away his most successful lesson plans. He refused to lean on what he knew. Perhaps that is what moves him now to leave Manhattan for life in the country. He will soon try his hand at nurturing other living things as a garlic farmer. John, may garlicky sauces simmer in your kitchen, and may you live happily in the house you build yourself, or don't. Whichever way, I'll be watching.